truly, the best is still yet to come. It's wild watching that video. I remember looking at it and just going, that's happened in a year, you know? And having to, with the team, work through, go, okay, we can't literally show a video for like the whole time, you know, or whatever, but we could have. Like, there's so much happening. We could have grabbed stories out of small groups. There's just so much happening, but just some highlights from the last year. Can we just give God glory for all that he's done? Come on, Beaumont. And God, listen, I want you to hear this. Like, there's always more. There's always more. And I just feel like there's this place that God pushes us where he says, can you keep up? Like, I've got more I want to do. And so as we move forward as a church, I mean, what we're seeking to do is just to keep up. Just keep up with God's doing. And so here's what I'm going to do today with the time that we have left. I want to kind of let you know some of the things we're talking about behind the scenes. And then I want you to hear how that applies to you and what all this means for us. For us as individuals. So, first of all, it's no secret. Like, what we've seen happen at Beaumont has been absolutely, absolutely incredible. It's 168 people that have committed their lives to Christ there at Beaumont in 12 months' time. Come on, everybody. I mean, and we've seen people baptized. Here's the other thing that a lot of people don't think about. Everyone goes, oh, you know, there's that many people there and there's people getting baptized. Here's the other thing I love about the campus and what God's doing with you, Beaumont, is that it creates channels, it creates places for people who have a gift to step up and use that gift. Does that make sense? Like, instead of us going, oh, there's this, just this thing, and it's only, like, we want to make room for people who are called by God, because we believe everyone is, to find their place within the body of Christ. And so being able to do the campus out there allows us to be, hey, we don't just have one leader over K through fifth, we have two. God's raised up two, you know, because now we have two camp. We could do that. And it just allows for people, it allows opportunity for people to grow into the leadership that God's placed in their life. And so I love that about the campus and what God's done there. And watching these rising stars in our ministry of God that God is raising up. Worship leader, John, I want to look at you and right now and tell you, I'm so proud of how you've stepped up and led that campus in worship. It's incredible. Come on, church, let's thank him. And all the teams that I think of over there, you guys are just killing it. You're doing such a good job. All of you working in tech and everything that you've done, I love it. I love the teams that have been taking place. And so listen, here's what's in our heart. We genuinely believe that Beaumont's the first of many to come, okay? And so over the next several years, we're actually going to launch more campuses. Now, there are places that are in our hearts, like very specifically, okay? Some of those places would include San Bernardino's in our heart, okay? We have Moreno Valley in our heart. I think Moreno Valley first, like it's definitely in our heart. I want to tell you this, that an opportunity has opened up for us to actually plant out in Upland, okay? And so what's wild, there's a whole story behind that. I almost said I don't have the time to get into it, but I got the microphone, so I'm going to tell you anyway. Listen, when we came out to plant here, Tatum and I almost actually planted in Upland. We were praying between Upland and here, okay? And just through a series of events, God said, no, I want you to plant in the Redlands, kind of Beaumont area first. And we were just, okay, it doesn't make sense. Everything was kind of, but we were, okay, God, we're obedient. And through a series of events, about 5-6 months ago, I walked into a meeting with a man who's like, hey, Pastor Chris, I want to talk to you. I'm actually purchasing all of these old, really cool venues like the Fox Theater in all these different cities, and I want citizens to be in every single one of them. I'm looking at him, like, are you serious? He's like, yeah, I'm paving the way. We're going to make it happen, and all this. I'm like, you got to be kidding me. And he goes, yeah, the first one's in Upland. And when he said that, I went, oh my gosh, Lord, because God spoke that to us 4.5 years ago. I had a man praying over us that actually verified God was just going everywhere we went, and God said there's going to be something out in that way. And then God opened up that door, everybody. Come on, let's give God glory for that. So it's absolutely incredible. Now, so all that's happening behind the scenes, but here's what I want you to know as we move toward that. See, because let me say why, because I want you to hear this. It's not the what. Oh, we're going to plant a campus. Like, who cares? Like, why? We believe that the local church, that God's work through the local church is the hope of the world, amen? And that as people As we gather together and do life around the person and work of Christ, God, as we have a community around the person and work of Christ, God breathes upon that in a supernatural way. He works through that in a supernatural way to change the lives of those involved and to touch the community that God's placed that church in, okay? So what we want to do is create those places where people can do life around the person and work of Christ. We live in an age now, we live in a day now, where if something's 15 minutes away, 20 minutes away, you're not going to get in the car and fight traffic and get all whatever all the way over there. And so that's why we said that 15, 20 minutes away, just kind of wherever we just put little local expressions to join with the work that God is doing in these places and see the kingdom grow. See, listen, there are still more lives that need to be changed. There are still more people that need to find hope, church. There's those lost kids that need to be brought home. And he does that when he puts a local expression of community in communities that are willing to shine the light of the gospel into those communities. And so that's the why. Also, think about what I said with Beaumont. We want to see God raise up more leaders and give more opportunity for those of you that have gifts and callings inside you to actually step into that. We want to create more space for that to take place. So all of that's in our heart, all of that's in our mind, where we believe that God's going to do it in his time. It's on the board. We're praying. Now, here, as we move toward that, I want you to understand what we're thinking behind the scenes, that as we move toward that, there's some things that we feel like God's called us to focus on very specifically and distinctly. Before we're able to actually go out and do these things, there's like, you know, like dominoes, like God's starting to set them all up, you know what I mean? But there's that first like couple that first one you hit and then everything kind of unfolds, right? So we feel like one of those first dominoes is actually finding a permanent venue for our Redlands campus. And so, yeah, I know, I'm really excited about it too. But now here's the thing with that. I want you to know we have been looking relentlessly. So permanent venues, we have been looking relentlessly. We are now on our third agent. That's because every agent, I'm like, come on, go get him. They're like, I'm going to go get him. I'm like, you're not going hard enough. Like, he's like, nothing's available. I'm like, knock on doors. Do you mind if we take this facility? Like, I don't care what it takes. Like, I'll do it. I have done it. And anyway, just so you understand how much we're pushing forward, like we really, really are. And so we've asked around. Here's what's happening in Redlands is that we're actually being a little picky. I want you guys to hear this. People come to me all the time, they're like, Chris, there's this warehouse. I'm like, where is it? They're like, it's about 9.5 miles off the freeway. It takes about 20 minutes from the freeway to get to, and it's totally dilapidated, but there's plenty of land and park. I'm like, yeah, the reason no one's there is because of where it is, okay? And so I want you to hear we're being a little picky. We as the Redlands campus right now, the Redlands campus pulls from about 23 different cities, people driving in. Like, we've done the math. We brought up the people are coming in from all over the place. So we feel like it's very, very important to be strategic, okay, to actually put that in a location that's near the freeway. It's easy to get to. And so that's what we're looking for. That's what we're looking to do. We've made offers on 3 or 4 places, and it's been a no, 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 no. And I want you to hear this. I don't get depressed. Okay, I'm lying to you. Sometimes I get very depressed. Tatum's looking at me like, oh, don't you tell me. But here's what God spoke into my heart on the last kind of no that we got. And usually it's not anything from our end, like we can't service the loan or we can't, it's not that. It's trying to figure out parking is a massive issue, okay? And so it's always come down to that, like use and all this. We fight very hard for it. But here's what God spoke into my heart. I'm frustrated. What is going on? And God's like, I'm using all the no's to lead you to my yes, okay? I'm using all the no's to lead you to my yes. And guys, God's got a yes out there for us. And we knock on doors until he says, here's the yes. Amen? Does that make sense? And we're believing God for that. Believing God to do that. So here's kind of what that looks like so you guys understand kind of what we're looking for for Redlands. Campus is that right now what Redlands pays for to use all the venues that we use here, Clock, Fox, I mean University, Clock, Fox, that paying for our offices, paying for all the storage of all the trailers and all that. Everything we do to pay that amount of money could actually service a loan on something that we'd own. Okay, so that's the very frustrating part. It's like we're paying this out every month. I'm like, we could own something or we could lease something. And so that's where we're at with that. That's why we're looking so hard. It just makes no sense to keep throwing money into places that we're setting up and tearing down when we could have something that we open with a key, everybody. That would be so nice. Come on, you know what I mean? That you don't get this in Beaumont, but here, like, I talk and I hear myself talk like off the wall. Have you ever had a conversation on your phone where it's like bouncing back and you can't talk? That's what it's like every time I'm on this stage, all right? So God bring us a building and help the pastor out. All right, so gosh, you wait till our worship. Anyway. Where was I? Oh, yeah. So that could service alone what we pay out every week. So we just really feel like that needs to happen. One of the things is that do we purchase or do we lease? We're wrestling with all that. Understand this: for us to go out and buy something right now, here's what we're looking for: about 25,000 to 30,000 square feet that'll allow us with parking and everything that you need for that. That allows us to do about 800 to 1,000 seat auditorium. For the Redlands campus, that would cost us about $4 to $5 million to purchase. In order to purchase, everyone wants about 30% down, okay? So that's what we're looking at. And that's about 1.2 to 1.5 million that we'd have to have down. We're currently saving toward that, all right? Many of you have given over the last couple years toward that. And I want you to know all of that is tucked away in what we call our legacy fund. And that's what we're going to use when we go to purchase the facility. Do we have $1.5 million yet? No. So if you have $1.5 million, we'd love it, okay? I always say this. I say, God's got all the money. We already have all the money. It's just in our pockets. That's all. Anyway, but that's where that's at. And I'll let you guys know when we find a place. Our thought is that as we lock in locations that get really close, we'll bring it to you, let you know what the difference is between where we're at, where we need to be, and we'll deal with that then, everybody. And I'm praying. I want to be able to bring, we're working on a lot of things right now. I want to be able to bring something to you like by the end of this year, if not January, February next year, so we can see it, okay? All right, that's where that's at. One that you know too, Beaumont, we are actually this year getting very, very intentional and serious about finding you a permanent venue, okay? And so Pastor Steve and the team are beginning to look. The amount, same thing, the amount we pay for to use the school is very close to the amount that we could actually lease or purchase something for to pay a mortgage for. And so we're looking very intentionally out in Beaumont too, everybody. We're gonna find you a home. How's that sound, everybody? Come on. So that's a big focus. We feel like that's a domino that needs to be hit. Everyone, you on page so far? Does that make sense? Let's go do more campuses. I'm like, can you imagine like setting up and tearing down in 10 locations? I don't think so. Like, unless God wants to raise up a team. Our tear down team one time, I was talking about the permanent venue and they're looking at me and they looked all bummed out. I'm like, why are you bummed out? They're like, what will we do if we have a permanent venue? I'm like, we'll find something else for you to tear down, all right? Like, there's always room. Now, the other thing that we're focusing on as we move toward that, you guys, that God's called us to, is a focus on leader development, okay? This is something we're becoming very, very serious about. We believe God is calling us to work towards some kind of leadership training program where we can develop and train future leaders in ministry, okay? This is specifically for people and students who feel called into full-time vocational ministry. We want to start a program, possibly a school someday, that will allow you to get some experience and to get poured into and to get some training in leadership development. I believe today one of the things that's lacking most in the church across the nation and world is leaders, okay? We have a lot of people who just are willing to kind of go with the flow, but not a lot who know how to step up and lead something and stand for something. And we believe that God is calling us to strengthen our leadership core through a leadership training program, school. We've looked at lots of models. Pastor Steve and I are meeting regularly and beginning to talk about what that would look like. And we'd actually like to launch something early next year that'll be very, very specific. You'll know about it. It's very intentional. We'll announce it and we'll allow, if you feel called into that, we'll allow you to get signed up and we'll start moving through. I picture students moving from all over the nation to come here and spend some time with us. Learning and growing and getting poured into to then either serve here and help be a part of leading and guiding what God's doing here, or be called back to their home church or wherever they came from to go and strengthen the church there. We believe God has called us to raise up some leaders. Come on, church, amen. So we're going to focus on that. Here's the other thing I want to tell you about is we have a focus right now on citizens worship, all right? Here's what's happening with citizens worship. Our citizens worship team has been working hard behind the scenes. What a lot of you might not realize is that many of the songs we sing on Sunday morning are actually songs from in-house, okay? They're songs that we've written, and we have decided this year to take the songs that are in-house and let them out of the house, everybody. We're gonna let others hear them. Like that song, Out of the Darkness. Out of the darkness, I come running. Yeah, that's a citizen song. That's the Dustin Lowe, and we wrote that. So we picture churches being out. We just want to resource churches with what God's done here with our music. And so we're working very hard on putting that together, and we should have our first EP out by February of this next year, everybody. Come on. We're gonna let that out of the house, everyone. So that's coming up, and just a lot of really exciting things that God's been doing. So those are the conversations we're having behind the scenes. We know, God, you called us campuses, but we need a permanent venue. We want to raise up some leadership. Man, we want to see this thing happen with citizens worship, and that's kind of like the big highlights, if you would. There's other things we're doing with small groups in this next year, but those are the big highlights. Here's what I really want you to understand. All of that, yay, God, let's go. But I want you to hear this. Our vision, our biggest vision is you. And here's what I mean by that. Citizens isn't called just to move into buildings and start schools and work. Like, the primary purpose of everything we do is to see you catch God's vision for your life. So our vision is to see you catch God's vision for your life. How many of you know that God's got a vision for your life? Like, and that the church is meant to help you walk in that vision. That we together help one another live out the calling of God, the vision of God on each of our lives. And that's what we're looking to do. That's what we're aiming to do. Nothing makes me more excited. Like, if you could say, Chris, you're gonna have this, this campus or that building, this, or you could have these lives changed. Give me the lives changed. These things are just vehicles that God uses to change lives, to give us a place, a greater platform and strength to see even more lives changed through life in Christ. That is what it's all about. Our vision is you catching God's vision for your life. And to do it with some friends. It was interesting in that video that we did. we interviewed people. What's your favorite thing about Sisa? What do you like about Sisa? Every one of them. The community, the people, the friends. I went back. I said, hey, can you guys go back through the videos? Was there anything else in there? Like, did everyone just say community? We went back through it, and like I'm looking for, man, I really love the messages on Sunday morning. Just, like, I wanted to put some of that in there. Like, just, man, Pastor Chris is so anointed, and wow. It's like nothing. No one said that, all right? What about, like, hey, our worship's incredible? It's like no one went there. Everyone, the first thing was, literally, put a camera. What is your favorite thing? Oh, the people. And here's what I thought to myself. They will know that you are my disciples by your love for one another. And God said, that's a healthy house right there. A healthy house is a house you look at and go, they're taught well, they're loved well, they're led well. Why? Because they're going, I just love these people. I love these people. They're great. That's the Spirit of God moving in our midst. That's God moving in our midst. That's the vision, friends. It's just to keep ourselves grounded. Keep it down home. You know what I mean? No matter what God's doing. Does this make sense, everybody? Like, no matter what God's doing, we just keep it real. We keep it down home. So we want to see you catch God's vision for your life. You know, Proverbs says this, Proverbs 29:18. Proverbs 29 says this, where there is no vision, this is in the popular translation, where there's no vision, the people perish or cast off restraint. But blessed is he who keeps the law. Now hang there. What Scripture's saying is if you don't have vision, if you can't see what God's up to, then you cast off restraint, you end up doing whatever. In other words, if you don't know what God wants you to do, you end up doing whatever you want to do, and whatever you want to do usually doesn't end well. You know what I'm saying? And so listen to it I don't typically do this, but I'm going to quote the message to you because I just love the way that it says it here. It says, if people can't see what God's doing, they stumble all over themselves. If people can't see what God's up to, if people don't see the vision, if you don't catch the vision God has for your life, if you don't know what God wants for you, then you'll stumble all over yourself. Could it be that the mess in your life isn't actually about the mess in your life? Maybe the mess in our life is about the fact that we don't have something bigger than the mess to live for. And some people get trapped. underneath this tyranny of just doing whatever. And when you do whatever, it leads to wherever. And some of you came in here today and you're just stuck in the middle of wherever. The friends, listen, the reason you're stuck there according to scripture is because you've been doing whatever. You're stuck in the middle of wherever because you're doing whatever. And God says, listen, I got bigger for you than whatever. Look at me, everyone. God's got a vision for your life. And my vision, our vision as a church is to help you catch that vision and live out that vision. Friends, that you'd get something bigger than this world and the stress and the mess, something bigger to live for. And God's got it for you. Come on, church, amen. Come on, church, amen. So that's our vision. So if you could see God do something in your life, I want you to go with me on a real quick journey. If you could see God do something in your life, what would it be? Like if I asked you to dream a little bit, look at me, dream a little bit. What dream would you dream if I asked you to dream a little bit? Now listen, put God in the middle of that dream. What dream would you dream if you knew God could show up and do? God could show up and lead you toward? What vision do you have? Catch a vision for your life. Listen, what impossible situation do you need to see made possible? What relationship do you need to see healed? Okay? What place in your life, what addiction needs to be overcome? Like, what is it? What is it in your life? If God could show up and tell a story, God, I'd want you to tell. Could you tell? Is it possible, Lord, that you would tell this story? Because listen to me, it's not just me asking you to get a vision for your life. This is God asking you to get a vision for your life. Listen to scripture, Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians 3:20 says, now unto him who is able to do. Do what? Just to do. Like God's able to do. Come on. You know what I mean? Like God can do anything he wants to do. Now unto him who's able to do. Are you thankful for a God who's able to do, everybody? Come on. He's able to do. Now watch this. He's able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we ask or think according to the power that works in us. Ephesians 3:20 is one of my life verses. I love it. Why? Because God's doing this. He's going, dream, church. Ask me something. Jesus said, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock at the door and it shall be opened unto you. God wants you to posture your life in a position of asking, of leaning into him. God wants you to posture the position of your life. Is this making sense? Not, oh, I'm stuck here with this in that. I'll never overcome. I'll never see healing. He doesn't want you living like that. And there's far too many people and far too many Christians today living with that stuck under the circumstances. God says, what in the world are you doing under the circumstances? I am bigger than your circumstances and I've got more for you than your circumstances have dished out to you. God says, the reason you're stuck is because you can't see past it. Get a vision for your life. I am able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all you could ever ask. Come on, somebody. That's a good spot to say amen. So listen. Ask him. What is it? Come on, ask. Here's what God does. He goes, oh, that's cute. Like, that's okay. Because my vision is actually bigger than the thing you're asking. Isn't that great, everybody? Like, you can't ever out-ask God. He's always ahead of you. His vision is always bigger than your vision. So God is trying to get you to see past what is and on into what could be. I'm talking to somebody today. Listen to me. You are stuck in the family cycle. Everyone was an alcoholic. Every marriage failed in my family. And I'm talking to you today and I'm saying, friends, just because that's the way it has been does not mean it's the way it has to be, because there is a God in heaven that wants to give you a vision past what you find yourself stuck with today. He wants to give you vision past it. Live bigger. See, you're saying, it's not gonna, it ends here. Because I'm gonna live with something bigger in sight. Amen? So guys, God's the greatest storyteller of all time, okay? God writes the best stories. Who writes those stories? God writes those stories. God writes those stories. Think about the stories God has written all over scripture. They're the best stories, right? I mean, you think about David and Goliath. Oh, that's an incredible story, right? You think about Moses leading the children of Israel out of slavery into the promised land. There's some of you in here today that are stuck in slavery and God wants to lead you into the promised land. You think about Gideon and his mighty men of 300 that went out and overcame an army of people that couldn't be numbered. Some of you in here today and you're going like, it just doesn't add up. The numbers don't add up. I don't see how it's possible. Well, it's possible with Gideon. It's possible with Moses. David and Goliath, you look and you say like, there's no way, right? And some of you are looking at your life just like David. There's no way to slay this giant. But there's this, in each of those stories, there's this yet God dynamic of where God shows up and says, oh yeah, watch me, I'll intervene. Let me tell that story. Let me tell that story, and the outcome will always be glory to God, who's the only one who could possibly tell that story. Come on, amen? Are you getting this today, or am I going too fast? God wants to tell that kind of story in your life. See, the problem is, I think a lot of times we get stuck at this. We read those stories and we go, oh, look what God did. Isn't that great? Look what God did with the walls of Jericho. Look what God did with Moses. Look what God did. Look what he did. And we see it as in this past tense what God did. Listen to me. The God who did is also the God who wants to do today. They're not stories that are just meant to read. They're meant to inspire you to live that kind of story today. God writes the greatest stories. So I wonder what kind of story he wants to write in your life. Now listen, God writes the greatest stories, but listen to me. His stories are told through our steps. His stories are told through our steps. God always takes the vision, listen to me. God always takes the calling. You are called. God wants to give you a vision. God always takes the vision, he always takes the calling, and he breaks his story he wants to tell into steps he wants us to take. Does that make sense? And so friends, a lot of people look at the story God wants to tell. I wanna see the marriage heal. I wanna break the addiction. I wanna someday start that ministry. I wanna start that business and give funds to help ministries and missions all over the world. I wanna, right? The vision, God always breaks the story down into our next step. Think about it, it's always the case. Moses lead the children of Israel out of slavery and into the promised land. How? Go to the Pharaoh. Gideon, I want you to take on this army with 300. How? Be obedient to me and dwindle it down to 300. God, that doesn't make sense. I don't like that. This is very scary. Just dwindle it down and trust me. Okay, God, next step, right? Peter, you're gonna walk on water. That sounds fun. How? You gotta get out of the boat. You know what I mean? The vision, right, the story. We wouldn't have the story of Peter walking on the water unless Peter actually got out of the boat. See, there's a step. So God tells great stories, but his stories are told through our steps. And friends, I want you to hear me today. I want you to hear me today. It's time to take a step. I want so badly for you to engage in everything that God has for you, to live out, to catch the vision of God, to live in the vision of God for your life. But here's what it's gonna take. Not just a vision that you see, but some steps that you take. It's time to take a step today. So here's what I'm gonna do. I just wanna push you. I wanna disrupt your life right now, okay? And say, that thing you've been dreaming about, the thing you've been praying, it's time. It's time to take a step. That's what we do here at Citizens. That's all we do, is we just simply come alongside you and go, we're gonna be with you in that step. We're gonna help you take that step. It's called walking, one foot in front of the other, and I'm with you every step of the way. And we're here for you every step of the way. Let's take that step together. So I wonder for you, friends, like what step is it? Where is God nudging you? Where is he pointing? For some of you, listen, your step is to go all in. You've been flirting around with God long enough. God doesn't like a flirt. God says we go all in. He's on my list. Listen, if he's not on the top of your list, it's not just about, God, you're in my list. A lot of people, God's in my list. God deserves top of the list. And for some of you, the step you need to take today is you've got to go all in. You've been out doing your own thing in your own way long enough. And when you do your own thing in your own way, it always leads to the same place it led the prodigal son. You know where it led him? To a pigsty. Sitting there with these pigs, trying to get full on what the pigs were eating. But friends, look at me. When you're out there trying to do this on your own, you're doing your own thing, this is where you end up. And I'm gonna tell you, you're not a pig. But you've been led to the places where the pigs are just eating the slop. And some of you are stuck there just eating that slop today. And God says, I've actually got more for you than that. It's time to come home. It's time to come home. It's time to get serious about your relationship with God. It's time to go all in. Come on, somebody, amen. And stop wandering those roads. Luke chapter 14, verse 23 says, the master said to the servant, go into the highway and the hedges and compel. I'm gonna say compel. Like, I'm gonna take you with me. Compel people to come in that my house might be full. This is the heart of God. God's heart is to take lost kids who are out doing their own thing and to help them find home. The heart of God is that us as a church, that we as a church would go out to a people who are out trying to do their own thing in their own way and help them find home, okay? Bring them home. Guys, God says, I want my house, say with me, full. Some people go, aren't there enough people? Nope, not in God's eyes. People, it's not about the numbers. Oh, read your Bible. There's a lot of people right now. Listen, as long as heaven and hell are real, which they are, the church has to grow. We have got to reach some lost people. We've got to see some people come home. We have to help people take that next step, the step that some of you are going to take today. It's finally time to go all in with God. And so the reason you don't feel at home wherever you've been wandering to is because it's not your home. You're not a pig, my goodness. Come home. God's got more. And church, we will relentlessly pursue. He says, compel people. You've got to come with me. Get people around. The personal work of Jesus. Every one of us have in our sphere of influence, there are people who are lost, some of God's lost kids. And all they need is an invitation home. All they need is someone to compel them. The way that God works, the way that God grows the church is through the church. The way that God touches lives is through the community, a community that's willing to open their mouth and compel some people. And friends, this year, we're gonna compel more than we've ever compelled before. We're gonna bring some lost kids home. Come on, church, amen. Come on, Bohan, amen. I want you to think through your sphere of influence and the people God's placed in your life. Let's take it serious. We want to help people take this step, to step home. For some of you, for some of you, your next step is to get some help. It's time to get some help. Ecclesiastes says this in Ecclesiastes chapter 4. I think I have it. Ecclesiastes 4:9 says this, two people are better than one, for they can, say it with me, help one another. It's time to get some help. Some of you in here today, you're in this place, you're stuck in a place that you can't get past on your own. And I'm gonna tell you something, that's okay. Don't be ashamed of that, don't be embarrassed of that. Every one of us at some point in our life are going to be stuck in a place that we can't get past on our own. That's how life works. You learn to walk with a little help, learn to talk with a little help, you learn to write with a little help. And what in the world makes you think you get to a place in your life where you don't any longer need some help, okay? You have to be okay with the fact, I need help. My marriage, we've gotten to a place in my marriage where we can't figure this out on our own. We need a little help. That's okay. I don't know why in the world we've moved to this place where we become ashamed of the very thing that God's created us to need. You need help. God built us in a way that we grow, or God's provided for us in this fallen world a place where we grow and we get help through the body of Christ. That's what the church does. Is that we help one another take steps forward into everything God has for them. So when your marriage gets to a place where it's stuck and you can't figure out this thing, get some help. When you have an addiction that you keep falling into and you can't overcome, get some help, right? When you have an issue in your life, a pride or lust or whatever it might be, listen, get some help. When you keep wandering down that dead-end road and you know that dead-end road so darn well because you're there all the time, and you're like, this is a dead-end road. Why do I keep walking down this? I know it's a dead-end road. Why do I keep? Listen, because you need some help. You need some good people who love Jesus standing on that front of that road saying, don't go down the road. We're going to tackle you, boy, and not let you go down this road. We're going to lead you, girl. We're not going to let you go down this road. You need those kind of people in your life. Friends, it's time to get some help. But you can't get help if you keep hiding. You can't hide and have help at the same time. And some of you, the step you need to take today is to come out of hiding. To let your life mingle with the people God's put in your life in the body of Christ, in the church. It's time to get in a small group, to open up your life to some people who are gonna love you, pray with you, and walk with you into everything God has for you. Friends, it's time to get some help. Gotta let the right people in your life. Some of you keep going down you're going, I could do it on my own. No, you can't. You can't do it on your own. You need some people. And you're like, but I've got people. Yeah, they're the same people that keep leading you down to that dead end road every single time, right? It's the same people. And so it's time to get serious about your relationships and your friendships. And that's the step you need to take. You got some people that you need to let out of your life today. You need to create some boundaries. And then you got some people, look around, that you need to let into your life. Okay? It's time to take that step. Others of you, your step is to live out your purpose. Got to live out your purpose. Ephesians chapter 3, or chapter 2, verse 10 says this, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand, that we should walk in him. Listen to me, you're here on purpose and with a purpose, every single one of you. God has uniquely placed within you purpose. He's designed you intentionally for such a time as this. You're not here on accident. You're not breathing today on accident. You're not an accident. God put you here on purpose, with a purpose. There's something unique inside of you that he wants you to discover and to live out. He's got a purpose for you. He's got a path for you. He's got a road for you to walk. Notice it says, God prepared them beforehand that we should what? Walk in them. That we should take one step after another step into everything God has. And some of you, it's time. Listen, it's time to live out your purpose, to step into that today. God's saying this in Ephesians, saying, let me tell the story. I've got a story I want to tell through your life. I got a purpose. So many people don't sense that. Thought they're looking for meaning in everything else. But friends, you're never going to find meaning and significance until you find meaning and significance in the purpose God's created, to the meaning and the significance God's designed for you. And so that's your step today. Let God tell the story. Walk in the things he's prepared beforehand for you to walk in them. Surrender to that. So let God tell the story through your life. Let God tell the story through your singleness. Listen, you're single today. God's got a story he wants to tell. My goodness, let him tell the story. Let God tell the story through your marriage. Let God tell the story through your kids. Let God tell the story through your profession. Let God tell the story in your neighborhood and in your friendships. Let God tell the story through you overcoming that addiction. Let God tell the story. Let God tell the story of using broken things to bring about healing. Let God tell the story of past things being used by God for future glories. Let God tell the story. Live out that purpose. I wonder where your story's led you today. Where's your story led you today? Some of you are in here today and you're like, well, I'm not where I thought I would be. This is where my story's led me. It's nowhere I thought I would be. And I'm frustrated. I'm discontent. And let God tell the story, my friends. Others of you are here like, I'm right where I aim to be, but I'm not as happy as I thought I'd be. Let God tell the story. Some of you are like, I'm old. My story's over. You're breathing. God's still telling a story. Come on, amen. Let God tell the story. Here's what I want to push you to right there, right now. Is that you understand that no matter where your story is today, that God wants to tell a story. He wants to write upon the pages of your life a story of redemption and salvation. Your job is to yield to the storyteller, to take the step he's asking you to take. So here's what we did today. In light of Beaumont's birthday, we got everyone a gift. We got you a birthday gift. Can we get the birthday gifts? Come on, where are those at? We got some birthday gifts for you today. Beaumont, they're underneath your seat. Go ahead and get those on out. Get those on out. Let me walk you through something. What you are getting right now is a journal from us. And here's what I want you to do with that. Take this serious. Listen, you hear me all the time when I'm preaching, I'll talk about journaling. Tate and I journal. We love to journal to write down our thoughts, our prayers, and everything. Here's what I want you to understand. God is going to tell a story through your life. And what I want you to do is to use these journals. Listen, you use this to journal the story God's telling in your life, all right? Do this. They're small, so you could throw them in your purse or throw them in your pocket. Or some of you got a little hip bag, right? Those are cool. Put them in. Oh, no, okay. Don't wear those. If you got that on, I'm sorry. I love you. Anyway, throw a citizen sticker on it. It's all good. So here's what I want you to do. Seriously. Look at me. God's going to tell a story in your life this year. And what I want you to start doing is this. Take this journal with you and just start writing out. Write out the steps God's calling you to take. Do that today. The steps God's calling you to take. Write out the prayers that you're praying. Write out the notes in church that you're taking. Write out the struggles that you're having. Just start to write those things out. Get them out of your heart. Just get them out. And start to lay all that stuff out before God. This is a journal where you're just going, God, I'm going to pour my heart out to you in this. And as you do, here's what's going to happen. You're writing those prayers. You're taking those notes. You're writing out what you think your next steps are. You're writing out your frustrations. You're journaling all that stuff. But you're being intentional to go, God, this is my where I'm going to give it. This is my give it to God journal. Okay, this is where I'm giving this to you. This is where I'm learning from you. So I'm here. I'm going to do that. Now watch. Here's what's going to happen. This is what's happened for Tate and I over and again. That's why I'm doing this for you guys. Is that we can look back, Tate and I, right now, at years and years of journals. Tatum from fifth grade. We can look back at years of journals and see God answering prayers, God showing up, God being faithful. Oh, look, on this page, I thought all life was over and there was no way. Oh, look, 5 pages later, 10 pages later, oh my goodness, God came through in a miraculous way. Here's where I'm crying out to God, and here's where I feel, you know, empty, and here's where God showed up. And here's what begins to happen. Watch me, is that page after page, year after year, you start to go, wait, I know this story. I get this story. It's the same story over and over again. It's God's story. It's the story of me crying out to God and wondering and looking and what, and it's the story of God then showing up. And what begins to happen is when I get into one of those moments that maybe some of you find yourself in today, I go, oh, been here before. And I know the end of this story. It's a story of redemption. It's a story of salvation. It's a story of Jesus showing up and doing what only Jesus could do because I've seen him do it before. I'm going to trust him to do it again. And you'll see yourself begin to build some faith in your life because God loves to tell stories. Let him tell the story. There's also a card in there. It says, it's time. I believe it says it's time. It should, if all things went well. It's time to, and here's what I want you to do today. As an act of response and worship, I want you to really think about, it's time to. What's your next step? It's time to. Because our vision is you to catch God's vision for your life. He's tell a story in your life. And those stories are told through our steps. It's time to. What is that thing? If you'd write that out today on your way out, we have some installments that you can go out and you could clip your it's time to card onto. And here's what we're going to do today. Both campuses, we're going to collect all those cards. It's time to. It's time to. And here's our guarantee to you. You write out what you believe God's calling you to do, and we are going to commit to praying for you and the step God's calling you to take in this season of your life. We're behind you. Like I said, we're here to help you with those steps. We're behind you every step of the way. So if you write that out today, we'd love to pray. Church, can we thank God that he's a God who loves to tell stories, that he's a God of redemption, he's a God of healing.